Warning, today's episode contains Glee. If you are offended by this totally not serious musical teenage soap opera, you might want to consider buggering off. And come back next time when your senses aren't being offended. Otherwise, enjoy! Because you see, here's where she meets Prince Charming, but she won't discover that it's him till chapter 3.
Stop. Just stop.
Doctor, what are you doing here?
I'm here to tell you not to turn this review into a musical.
Oh. Well, there goes that idea. So, hello, and welcome to Let's Read with LabbyDragon, because inside there's a double-sided poster that pleases both Ben and Quinn, and Ben and Rachel fans. As long as... well, not as long as I can remember, but certainly since Sabrina the Teenage Witch came on, I have been reading books based on TV series. Is it because they're the best books ever written? Well, sometimes, as in the case of a select few Buffy novels I've collected. But usually it's just to have more material related to the show. I won't lie, I ate up the Sabrina the Teenage Witch books like they were candy. And really, they were mediocre at best, even when they were original adventures. If you're going to read a book based on a hit TV show, don't expect much. The premise of Glee the Beginning is that it fleshes out the backstory of the Glee Club based on some information revealed in Season 1. Though that makes it pretty inconsistent with Season 2, if you could even call it consistent with the first season in the first place. Right, so let's talk about what characters feature in the book. As the cover indicates, our main characters are Rachel, Finn, and Quinn. And relegated to the back cover are the rest of the Glee Club: Kurt, Mercedes, Tina, and Artie. Guest appearances made by Sue, Emma, Figgins, and Schuster. Instead of taking the time to talk about each of these characters, I'm gonna jump into the plot and explain later.
Lazy.
You're still here? Shouldn't you be off saving the time-space continuum or something?
It's the space-time continuum. Do we really need to have the time travel talk again?
No. Can I do the review now?
Fine.
Thank you.
But I simply cannot do it alone.
The book begins with an over-description of Rachel Berry. As if you wouldn't know who she was or what she looks like, because you would totally be reading this book if you weren't a fan of Glee. Rachel, in all her dorkily dressed, self-centered diva glory, marches into the principal's office to beg Figgins to let her take over the morning announcements. And because Rachel in this book is more annoying than she was in the first episode, he gives in just to shut her up. So, of course, Rachel proceeds to use the morning announcements as a venue to introduce her talents to the school. And a side note, Schuster makes one of his many pointless cameos, wherein the kid's singing inspires his poor, unfortunate soul. However, what really gets to me about this whole bit is where the homecoming king and queen are to be announced at the dance after the game, when every high school I've ever known announces the homecoming court before the game, so that during halftime, the homecoming court can be presented, while the marching band stands there playing One Moment in Time over and over and over again. Sorry, bit of a flashback there. Moving on, we move on to the Glee kids at lunch. Basically, with a rundown of the typical social hierarchy in high school, except for where the Glee kids are the least popular. I know at my school, the show choir kids were among the most popular, though guess I don't know what it's like to be at a school that gives a shit about football and cheerleading as a social status. We also get Kurt making goo-goo eyes at Finn, in case you don't watch the show and don't know he's gay, which you probably know even if you don't watch the show.
Oh, to be a greasy pepperoni on that piece.
Yeah. I don't think Kurt would want to be greasy, no matter how close it got him to Finn's lips back when he had that huge crush on him. Though the sentence structure does match early Kurt dialogue, decently, not perfectly, but decently. In this scene, we get a few moments of point of view whiplash, which herald things to come. While still technically being written completely in third-person omniscient point of view, it's as if the novel tries to imitate the ease with which the show switches between points of view. But in a book, that's never going to go well. It's never at the fanfiction level, but the point of view swapping can be incredibly jarring. While the book does strive to focus each chapter on either the Glee kids, whether they're all together in smaller groups or just Rachel, or the popular kids, mostly Finn and Quinn, it never masters how to tell us everything that's going on from all points of view without bluntly reminding us that it's trying to be a multi-point of view TV show. There's a side point where the Cheerios are charging for homecoming votes, and Rachel leads a one-woman crusade against them. It ends with Kurt inviting Rachel to Glee Club. Cue the next day, where Rachel completely takes over Glee Club, much to Mercedes' complete outrage and the annoyance of everyone else. But she's their only hope for not embarrassing themselves in the Fall Into Love With Music recital on OMG Friday. Although the reason they're going to fail isn't because they can't sing, it's because their song choice is Tonight from West Side Story. Yeah, no wonder the rest of the student population thinks you're so lame. And no, I'm not saying West Side Story is bad. I'm saying it's annoying. Just try to sit through the overture. Cut to the next morning, where Tina and Artie listen to the morning announcements as Rachel continues her crusade against the Cheerios voting booth. And then, something exciting happens!
I don't know who you think you are! A deep, brash voice interrupted Rachel's plea. The entire school immediately recognized it as the voice of Sue Sylvester, the legendary coach of the Cheerios. She was powerful and opinionated, and known for kicking Cheerios off the squad if they cried in public. But you are way out of line! Challenging the status quo is a deceitful and insidious tactic!
Why is this scene not in Rachel's point of view? We're way more interested in Sue being the crazy bitch she is than the stupid budding romance between Tina and Artie. Especially since, at the time this book came out, we knew exactly where that was going. Let me just drop this on you because it's the most of Sue's crazy we're gonna get in this novel.
I'll tell you what unethical is. Unethical is you denying my Cheerios the right to raise money for their tanning needs. These are some talented athletes who are going all the way to the top, and you, young lady, need to stick to your lonely path of unrealized ambitions.
Not only are we robbed of an epic moment between Rachel and Coach Sylvester, the point of view switches to Mr. Schuster being inspired by Rachel's singing. And we're given another reason to hate Terry. Thank goodness she's gone now. As apparently she said, dancing would give her lupus. Stupid Terry, don't you know? It's never lupus. Cue the Quinn chapter, which, like every other Quinn chapter, is about her sexual attraction to Puck despite her insistence on dating Finn. Puck also spent his summer as a pool boy, and by pool boy he means gigolo. So, being the bad boy sex lover he is, he gets Quinn to make out with him under the bleachers, where Quinn notes,
"For some odd reason, he made her think of juicy fruit gum. She used to love the flavor so much she wasn't able to chew it long before she had to, she couldn't help it, swallow it."
What the hell, Quinn? Maybe that's what's wrong with you. And let's not even get started on what a facepalm-inducing metaphor for sex that is. So Quinn pulls her lips away from Puck. And we catch up with Finn, who is waiting for Quinn to show up to Celibacy Club, a place which, understandably, he doesn't actually want to be. But Quinn herself invited him, and that's kind of relevant to his interests. Finally deciding to make a break for it, Finn goes out to search for Quinn. Sort of. He ends up hearing Rachel's voice coming from the auditorium, and wanders in, mesmerized by her voice. And there's a gratuitous Finn-Rachel moment, which used to be my ship back in the day. But then it was Rachel and that guy from Vocal Adrenaline, and then it was her and Finn again, and then I stopped caring. But mean old Quinn comes in and reminds Finn not to talk to the social service. The next chapter happens, surprisingly, in Mercedes' home. Not a place we really get to see in the show. And it's really nice. It seems like an appropriate home life for the character. Kurt shows up to apologize for inviting Rachel to Glee Club and... oh, God. Mercedes used to have this crush on Kurt before she fully realized he was gay. So they go out for milkshakes and run into Finn and Quinn on their post-celibacy club date. Finn ends up standing at the counter with them and, once again proving he's not a bad guy, exchanges pleasantries with the losers. Of course, Quinn doesn't like this, so she cracks the whip.
Suddenly, Finn thought of that creepy old movie where the crazy girlfriend throws the guy's bunny into a pot of boiling water.
Please. Just imagine Quinn doing this. Best image ever. And I would so believe it. Quinn would so kill somebody's bunny if it ensured she became prom queen. Quinn is a manipulative bitch, in case you didn't get it. Sure, they made her sympathetic with that whole teenage pregnancy bit, but she just went back to being a bitch the next season. Honestly, at this point, I found myself trying to figure out what was going to be the main conflict of this novel. 8 chapters in, and the plight of the Glee Club and Quinn's romantic issues were both equally treated as if they were the most important thing in the book.
It's a story about high school. How can you be confused about conflict? It's always about the high school hierarchy and how it sucks to be a teenager.
Okay, maybe thematically it's difficult to write a high school setting and not have the events address social expectations. But there does need to be something else clearly going on. You see, with the show, each episode has a theme, usually something that creates high-stakes conflict within each character's life, and the episode revolves around the dramatic question of how they're going to deal with it. This novel, however, has two completely different dramatic questions, and the Glee storyline is weaker, even though it should be the centerpiece. And it's treated as though it is. Quinn's risks are so high that her story drowns out everything else, as much as I hated it.
Hey, wait. Did you just use me to segue into a storytelling rant?
Yes. Yes, I did. The next chapter exists to say that the Glee kids don't want to go to the homecoming dance because they fear being humiliated there. Which they are on a regular basis at school, so they can justifiably assume it will be true. Rachel is incensed by this. If you've ever wondered why Miss I'm Going to Be Huge on Broadway, Rachel Berry, doesn't go to a performing arts high school, this chapter hits it right on the nail. It's her fear of someone that might be better than her. Of not standing out. But then the book promptly glosses over it. It's another loss of an amazing direction this novel could have gone in.
Everyone knew he'd slept with all kinds of MILFs through his joke of a pool cleaning business over the summer, and although he'd gone to the last meeting of the celibacy club, she seriously doubted his commitment.
This book just used MILF as a legitimate part of the narration.
What? No sparkle motion joke?
I'm sorry. I was too distracted by the degradation of literature.
You do know that language changes over time, right? And that sometimes narration is made casual to reflect the character?
We all have our triggers. The term MILF happens to be one of mine.
Fine, fine. Sorry, I...
Right then, if someone will allow it, we'll continue with the review. Quinn gets a text from Puck, inviting her to talk in a janitor's closet. Yeah, she really thinks she's going there just to talk. And I think Puck thinks that too. Puck doesn't do so good with honest emotion. It goes about as expected, and Puck backs her into the door the second she closes it.
And she couldn't help but kiss back.
Just bring your knee up, bitch. He's right in front of you. Honestly, she acts as if she's 100% trapped, but Puck is wide open for defensive attack. She does leave eventually and get to class, though I doubt Puck does. Back with the Glee Club, Rachel wants to do their performance of Tonight in poodle skirts, because she's a moron sometimes. Luckily, the rest of the Glee Club votes on a much more sensible costume. Rhinestone studded vests and black shirts. Wait, what? In a surprising choice, Rachel's chapter begins in her home, but not in her room. And actually has her interacting with her fathers. Not something we get to see in the series, really. She does go to her room eventually and starts thinking about her moment with Finn. It's also mentioned that one of the boys she kissed at theater camp decided he was gay after. If you're clued into the irony of that, you're laughing your ass off right now. Turns out Finn somehow gets Rachel's IM, and IMs her on a completely generic IMing system, even though MySpace is plugged like hell, and tells her anonymously, despite his really obvious screen name, that the Cheerios are plotting their revenge. A revenge which Quinn had made him swear into and yet never made him do anything. Jump to the following day, where the decorations committee is ignoring Tina and the job they're supposedly there to do. Santana does, however, take the time to give Tina a slightly toxic fog machine that the Cheerios had decided not to use. Which is a bit surprising, because Sue has always cared more about how the Cheerios look than their health, but plot device away! So finally, it's Friday, the day of the Fall Into Love With Music recital. And the Glee Club is freaking out because Tina is late. Then in she runs with the supposed stroke of genius that is the fog machine. And after Rachel has to rouse the troops out of their stage fright, Santana ensures that the sabotage goes as planned by distracting the boy running the show, ensuring that the fog machine stays on too long. Rachel sings long past when the others fall out coughing, and poor Kurt has a terrible sense of kinesthetic awareness and falls right off the stage into the orchestra pit. All in all, they were saved from a bad performance by a complete disaster. I'm not sure which the greater of the two evils is. The following Monday, Rachel goes to get those transfer papers to the performing arts high schools she really ought to be at. But as she's leaving the guidance office, she sees Finn. So what does she decide? That her measly chance of dating Finn is more important than relocating. Moron. So she plots Glee's big comeback at the homecoming dance. There is that little fact that Glee Club hates her now. More than they did before. Cue the next Quinn Finn Puck chapter, set at practice.
Quinn's hair was pulled back into a ponytail, as it always was for practice, letting her sexy little ears stand out. Puck wished he could put one in his mouth and suck on it like a lollipop.
Ew! Not to the ear-sucking itself, but to the description of the ear-sucking. And the fact that I find Puck utterly repulsive. Are you taking notes?
No.
Anyway, Quinn decides to start playing the How Jealous Can I Make Puck game and invites Finn to go hot tubbing with her after the homecoming dance. Aw, these authors think they're clever, don't they? Rachel uses her spot on the morning announcements to publicly apologize to Glee. I love that we get to see this little glimmer of humble Rachel. As much as her self-centeredness is a comedic force, I can't help but enjoy these moments. Maybe because Rachel is a caricature of the kind of person I am. But this isn't about me. Kurt decides to go with Mercedes to the dance, though the poor dear is still disillusioned that it might be something like a date. Meanwhile, Tina saves the decorations committee's asses with her spray-painted stars and has a then-uncharacteristic moment of pure confidence and forgetting to stutter. She gets Artie to go to the dance with her. And now, I want to read to you directly from my post-chapter notes on this one.
Oh God, Quinn! Why are you so dumb? It's no secret that no matter how sympathetic they've tried to make Quinn, they completely ruined her redemption, and I hate her once more. And this atrocity, with her just deciding to get into a car with Puck at night, just makes my theory that she's a fucking idiot solidified.
And that's all I have to say about that. Finally, we hit our big climactic Glee moment, where Rachel is relieved that the Glee kids show up. Finn notices Rachel for a second, but then gets pulled away by Quinn, who can't stop thinking about Puck and his formal wear. As expected, Finn and Quinn are crowned king and queen, and the Glee Club waits until after their special dance to hijack the sound system and perform Just Dance, which goes over better than expected as everyone except for Quinn starts dancing. Quinn's just a little butthurt that she didn't realize that being crowned homecoming queen wasn't going to bring her lasting attention anyway. Rachel also overhears Sue talk about how she bought a ridiculous number of votes to ensure the right outcome, which it seems she didn't have to do, as Finn and Quinn were winning anyway. But it was school money. Which leads us to our denouement, wherein Glee is called to the office to deal with the consequences of their performance, which Sue is standing around shouting about how severe it should be, when Rachel reveals the voting scandal. Figgins, beleaguered as always, doesn't do a recount, but gives the voting money to the Glee Club. Then, in what the authors must have thought was a very clever ending, Schuster walks into the office in a scene right out of the first episode.
But I simply cannot do it alone.
Just watch the first episode of the show. This book only marginally tries to cover the backstory referenced and fleshed out in even the first season of the show. And honestly, if I made a chart or a timeline, I don't think it'd line up. Especially not now that we're most of the way through the second season. And I can't fault them for information they didn't have, but I'm pretty sure the second season has shoved them firmly into the realm of slightly alternate universe. And really, that's what this is. I don't think it was ever intended to be canon material. It suffers from what I'm going to call TV novelitis. Often, when people go to write a novel based on a TV show, they write it as if it's a novel that wants to be a TV show, and the quality suffers so much. What I like about most of the books in the Buffy series is that they all understand that they're totally alternate universe material, and are often sold on that. Like the Dark Willow trilogy, wherein the premise is that what if Dark Willow had been around for longer? And because of that, they get written as though their novels being novels, and that's why they have such high quality work. So no, I don't recommend this, whether you're a fan or not. Fans aren't really gonna be happy with it, and if you're not, you won't care. If you're a completist personality and a fan of Glee, you're probably gonna buy this book and read it anyway just to say that you did. And yes, they did recently release another novel in the series. Am I going to read it? I hope not. I do hope to see you next time on Let's Read with Labby Dragon.
It's only forever, not long at all. Lost and lonely, no one can blame you for walking away. But too much rejection. No love injection. Life can't be easy. It's not always well. Don't tell me truth hurts, little girl. 'Cause it hurts like hell.
Yes.